Hi, good morning everyone. Welcome to today's service. For today, our call to worship will be from Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 to 16. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let us sing My Saviour's Love.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how He could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, when my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sin and my sorrows, He makes them His very own. Shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Turn we
So let's move on to the prayer of confession. You may take the next minute or so to reflect and have your own time with God. I will lead us in a prayer after. Trust in ourselves, our own abilities, and rely on our own strength instead of trusting you. Many times, we fear men rather than you. We often set our affections on things of this world, like our jobs, people's praises, what is around us, constantly ignoring you. We have not followed your ways to love and care for those in need. Forgive us for our uncompassionate heart, for it does not demonstrate your love. We come before you today to say that we are sorry and to remember that with you there is forgiveness through Christ Jesus, who died on the cross for us. By his wounds, we are healed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello everyone. Welcome to Katong Presbyterian Church's online service. I'm Pastor Kuo Yong and I'm here to bring us the family news. First up, KPC Mission Month. Starting next week, which is 31st of May, it's Pentecost Sunday. And we will have a series of 5 talks about the mission of God. We have in stock for you 5 very good speakers who will teach us about missions. So look out for these talks and invite your friends to join in our services as well. May God speak through His servants to quicken our hearts and to participate in God's mission in the whole world. And next, will the real Christian please stand up? Now, these are three talks which we have also prepared for you next month on 31st of May, 14th of June, and 28th of June after our online services at 11:15 a.m. These three talks will be conducted via Zoom, and the links will be shared with you at a later date. Pastor Chingay of Hope Presbyterian Church will be covering for us topics like miracle healing services, word of faith, prophetic movement, alternative Christian churches. These are important truth and information that we need to learn if we want to be able to differentiate between truth and falsehood. So we hope you can be there at the three Sunday sessions which we prepared for you. Next up, celebrating the gift. Join us via Zoom for an evening of prayer for everyone. And we want to celebrate God's gift of the Holy Spirit to us at Pentecost. And the date is Friday, 5th of June, from 8 to 9 p.m. The link will be sent to us at the closer when we are closer to the date. And before we take up the offering, we would like to introduce to you a soon-to-be pastor of KPC. Good morning. I'm here with someone very familiar with us, but I still like to introduce him because recently this young man, Yao Qi, just graduated from Singapore Bible College with a Master's of Divinity, and he'll be joining our staff team very soon. So we would like to introduce him to you. And perhaps the first thing Yao Qi can do for us is, can you introduce yourself and your whole family to us?
Yeah, hi, Yao Qi here. So this is Grace, and with us is Janessa. Janessa is about 2 years and 1 month. And her current favorite storybook is Elephant and Piggy, something like that. Grace works in a hospital. She's an occupational therapist at a KK hospital. So she works with kids every day. And Janessa just turned 2. She'll be in childcare soon. If not, in this season, every day she's with me and we are playing with necklace and storybooks and walking by the canal. Looking at mushrooms. Mushrooms are your favorite, right? I think so. Yeah.
Maybe our church members would like to know, what do you do before this, and what makes you want to switch to become a pastor?
Right. I spent 4.5 years learning to be a teacher and teaching in secondary school, teaching English and social studies. I love teaching. Spend most of my time in the classroom. In the classroom, right? But the thing that I love most would be spending time with students. And I find myself always wanting to spend more time with students, talking about life. And I've always wanted to teach the Bible a bit more. I got to do that on the weekends, and hopefully in this new role I get to teach it a bit more often. And then hopefully as a youth worker in church, I still want to spend most of my time with young people and still in school, but hopefully now in the canteens. And I'm thinking about campus grounds, not in the secondary schools, in the canteens, at McDonald's, at the basketball courts. Maybe at the CC as well, bring young people there to serve the community. And there, I hope to meet them, talk about life, and really talk about faith and Bible.
Wow, that sounds very exciting. And I hope working at KPC will give you a lot of those opportunities. So maybe finally, just share with us, are there any things that we can pray for you and your family?
Yeah, I guess the biggest... The biggest insecurity I might have would be, I have an irrational fear that regardless of what I do, how much time I spend, nobody would turn to the gospel. Nobody would want to know God. the sense of no matter how I teach, no matter how I communicate, no matter how I invest myself, no hearts will turn. And therefore, I might sink into wanting to just keep spending more and more and more time in ministry and neglecting other things. And so therefore, I would say, pray with me that my heart will be secure enough in the spirit and power of God.
Amen. Amen. Indeed. God is with us. God is with you. God is with the church. And all of us will be praying together with you. It seems like there are two prayer items there. One, that God will work powerfully as you spend time with all the young people, bring them the work, the word, and the word may work in their heart, right? That's one prayer that we should pray for you and your ministry. And the other is that you have a deep security in the Lord, and therefore you will know how to spend your time wisely between family and work and perhaps other responsibilities. Great. Yao Qi will be serving with us from the 1st of June, and we'll be seeing him more often, I guess. And let's welcome him into the pastoral team as well as the church community, of course. Okay, thank you for this interview. I would like to say bye-bye to you until we see you again after the COVID, I guess. Okay, Jessa, say bye-bye. Bye-bye. Yeah. Let us now pray as we prepare for the offering. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we are grateful that during this period, you still provide for us. We still have food and clothing and a roof over our head. And for some of us here, Lord, you even provided sufficient for us such that we can still use what you give us to bless other people, to bless those who are needy, and as well as to provide for the expansion of your kingdom. Therefore, Lord, give us a generous spirit so that we may give generously to those who have needs. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us now give thanks. Dear Lord, thank you for leading us in giving to others. And we pray that, Lord, you might grant wisdom to our church leadership so that they might use whatever we have given to bless those who are needy and at the same time to expand the kingdom of God. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, Since the start of the circuit breaker and the worship service going online, we form these small prayer groups that pray together during our online worship service. And the feedback from our participants have been positive so far. Some of them told us that they felt connected with others despite the fact that we are all staying at home. Some also feedback that they got to know new friends through these prayer groups. And we are also very encouraged when some members came back and tell us that in the past, they did not pray with other people, but because of these small prayer groups, they started to do so. And therefore, we would like to encourage all of us to continue to pray with one another. We also thought that it is good to periodically reassign our prayer groups. This will generate new relationships as well as new conversations. So in the next few weeks, we will be informing you of your new groups. And if you have any feedback or if you would like to stay with the same group, you may like to tell your prayer leader so that he may let us know and we may take note of your requests. So prayer leaders, it's time for the prayer of the people. Let's start calling all our group members. And here are the prayer items. First, let us give thanks for the new relationships that are being formed through praying together. And let us remember Preacher Yao Qi and family as they start a new journey with the church. Remember Reverend Ron Tan and family as they make arrangements to come back home. Pray for spiritual growth among us as we equip ourselves through the sermons and programs in the coming month, the mission talks, the prayer night, and apologetic classes. Pray for mission work and missioners in our midst. There's ongoing evangelistic classes during this circuit breaker. People in our midst are reaching out to nurses in Serene Home, and we are also supporting the mission work in Tong San. Pray for our own witness. Each and every one of us here are witness to our neighbors during this circuit breaker. So that we may make full use of all the opportunities that God has given us to share the love of Christ with others. And finally, do remember members among us who are currently unwell and some have just gone through surgery. Let's pray for their recovery. Let us pray. Thank you.
Let us prepare ourselves and our hearts for the sermon with the next song, Show Us Christ.
Scripture reading today will be taken from Acts chapter 23. I will be reading from the NIV and we will begin at verse 11. Acts 23, verse 11. The following night, the Lord stood near Paul and said, "Take courage. As you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome." The next morning, the Jews formed a conspiracy and bound themselves with an oath not to eat or drink until they had killed Paul. More than 40 men were involved in this plot. They went to the chief priests and elders and said, "We have taken a solemn oath not to eat anything until we have killed Paul. Now then,
You and the Sanhedrin petitioned the commander to bring him before you on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about his case. We are ready to kill him before he gets here. But when the son of Paul's sister heard about this plot, he went to the barracks and told Paul. Then Paul called one of the centurions and said, "Take this young man to the commander. He has something to tell him." So he took him to the commander. The centurion said, "Paul, the prisoner, sent for me and asked me to bring this young man to tell to you because he has something to tell you." The commander took the young man by the hand, drew him inside and asked, "What is it you want to tell me?" He said, "The Jews have agreed to ask you to bring Paul before the Sanhedrin tomorrow on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about him. Don't give in to them, because more than 40 of them are waiting in ambush for him. They have taken an oath not to eat or drink until they have killed him. They are ready now, waiting for your consent to their request." The commander dismissed the young man and cautioned him, "Don't tell anyone that you have reported this to me." He then called two of his centurions and ordered them, "Get ready a detachment of 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, and 200 spearmen to go to Caesarea at 9 tonight. Provide mounts for Paul so that he may be taken safely to Governor Felix." I am now skipping forward to chapter 24, verse 1, the trial before Felix. 5 days later, the high priest Ananias went down to Caesarea with some of the elders and a lawyer named Tertullus, and they brought their charges against Paul before the governor. When Paul was called in, Tertullus presented his case before Felix. "We have enjoyed a long period of peace under you, and your foresight has brought about reforms in this nation. Everywhere and in every way, most excellent Felix, we acknowledge this with profound gratitude. But in order not to weary you further, I would request that you be kind enough to hear us briefly. We have found this man to be a troublemaker, stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. He is a ringleader of the Nazarene sect and even tried to desecrate the temple, so we seized him. By examining him yourself, you will be able to learn the truth about all these charges we are bringing against him." The Jews joined in the accusation, asserting that these things were true. When the governor motioned for him to speak, Paul replied, "I know that for a number of years you have been judge over this nation, so I gladly make my defense. You can easily verify that no more than 12 days ago I went up to Jerusalem to worship. My accusers did not find me arguing with anyone in the temple, or stirring up a crowd in the synagogues, or anywhere else in the city. And they cannot prove to you the charges they are now making against me. However, I admit that I worship the God of our fathers as a follower of the Way, which they call a sect. I believe everything that agrees with the law and that is written in the prophets. And I have the same hope in God as these men, that there will be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. So I strive always to keep my conscience clear before God and men. After an absence of several years, I came to Jerusalem to bring my people gifts for the poor and to present offerings. I was ceremonially clean when they found me in the temple courts doing this. There was no crowd with me, nor was I involved in any disturbance. But there are some Jews from the province of Asia who ought to be here before you and bring charges if they have anything against me. Or these who are here should state what crime they found in me when I stood before the Sanhedrin. Unless it was this one thing I shouted as I stood in their presence, 'It is concerning the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you today.'" Then Felix, who was well acquainted with the Way, adjourned the proceedings. "When Lysias, the commander, comes," he said, "I will decide your case." He ordered the centurion to keep Paul under guard, but to give him some freedom and permit his friends to take care of his needs. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church. My name is Daniel, and this morning I want to teach you from Acts 23 and 24. I thank you for tuning in and for inviting me into your homes. And I hope you don't mind if I made it a bit more casual by sitting down rather than using the pulpit, because I thought it would be easier if I do that as a talk. So I hope you don't mind and it doesn't distract you from God's word. If I do, you can either write us a comment and give us your feedback. If not, just focus on God's word and you will learn from him. I too don't want to do this alone, so I thought I'd invite a friend of mine called Tom the Teddy Bear. Tom, say hello. Hello. I thought I'd have some fun by bringing Tom, as I'll teach Tom as well. So if you allow me, let's go to Acts 23 and 24. But before that, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you that we still connect ourselves to virtually. And right now, O Lord, I pray that my words will be used by you and your Spirit continue to bring fruits to your people wherever they are. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we're doing Paul in the barracks and Paul on trial. You can look at that in your bulletin in the outline. But at the same time, though he's in barracks and on trial, God is at work. But what's exciting is this, a safe Singapore. I don't know about you, this week or just yesterday, I've heard so much about a safe Singapore. It starts from a safe opening coming June the 1st, and wait 1 month, you'll be safe transitioning and later safe nation. What it means in June the 1st, few things will be open. Schools will be open, and I hear that some of my children are excited. They had enough of home-based learning with their parents, and now they want to go back to school. That's so good to hear. I also hear now barbers and saloons can give full service, which means women and men can go colour their hair, cut their hair, wash their hair, and perm their hair. How exciting. But the most exciting, I think, is that now parents and grandparents can visit their children and grandchildren. It'll be exciting for Rodney and Irene, who can visit now Caleb. And of course, David soon and Josephine soon can visit their newborn grandson, Nathan. How exciting. But that's not where I'm getting. I'm actually wanting to share what McDonald said. We're back. Don't rush. Stay safe. Indeed, we need to stay safe, but not to rush. You see, I hope we don't go back to the hustle and bustle of life in Singapore. Because sometimes when we do that, we miss out on what God can do for us. And I pray that this morning's sermon will help us do that, to slow down, to remember God, and to learn a few lessons. So that's where we're going. Today's talk is, the outline is introduction, Paul in the barracks, God at work, Paul on trial, my point two, God at work. And I want to add to the speech that saved his life and conclusion. So that's where we're going. My introduction is this. In Acts 1:8, which says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and the ends of the earth. Many commentators, and I myself believe, this is kind of the theme verse telling us what's happening in Acts, and how, through the Spirit at Pentecost coming upon the apostles, that the word went out. Went up from Jerusalem, the base where Pentecost happened, to Judea, to Samaria, and now to the ends of the earth. I like this picture because this picture shows us that chapter 2 to 7 is where Pentecost happened and the Bible or the Gospel goes out in Jerusalem. Then chapter 9, verse 2 to 40, you get in Judea, and later in Samaria in chapter 8, verse 4 to 25. And chapter 13 to 28, where we are at now, is going to the ends of the earth. Okay, Tom? Remember that. So again, the outline, Paul and the barracks, God at work, the plot built, the plot blown, assurance and God's providence. You see, if you heard the message, a plot was building. The Asian Jews came into Jerusalem wanting to get rid of Paul. They tried to stone him, tried to drag him out, tried to kill him, but was protected by the Roman garrison. Then they tried to go to Sanhedrin to try to get him killed or trial, that failed as well. So what they do now? They set up a plot. But so 40 men took a vow to get rid of him, to kill him by not eating or drinking until this is done. This is the plot built up. Not only that, They went even to get the Sanhedrin, or the chief priests, and some of the elders to help out, because their plot was to get Paul and summon him to the Sanhedrin. And on the way down, 40 men were ambushed, whatever soldiers were there, and got Paul and killed him. The funny part is that if you follow the story, it sounds like one of those series where there's a plot and suddenly, in an unusual way, a young nephew of Paul overheard what they're saying. I don't know how he did it, but some commentators were suggesting that they may be speaking the Aramaic as the 40 Jews, thinking that the Roman soldiers speak Greek, does not understand. So as they're speaking loudly, the nephew heard. And we know after that, the nephew to Paul, Paul told the centurion and sent to the commander, and the commander protected Paul and left with 400 soldiers to Caesarea in the night. So the plot was blown. But I like my next point is about God's assurance. I like verse Acts 23, verse 11, which says, "Take courage, as you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome for God." This is, to me, another verse that seems to run for the next or the last part of Acts. You see, we know that Paul was a little discouraged as he was already beaten up and put in Sanhedrin. And now he's put in the barracks, and I think he probably be discouraged with his life almost gone by the Asian Jews. So here is God telling Paul, take courage. Because you see, in two other places where God uses the word take courage, in Matthew chapter 9, verse 2, and they brought him a paralytic lying on a mat or a bed. Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralytic, "Take courage, son, your sins are forgiven." Almost saying, "Take courage, son, I'm in charge." But that's not all. The other one that Matthew 14, 27 really put it in the context of how God assures them. "But immediately Jesus spoke to them saying, take courage, it is I, do not be afraid." You see, there was a point where the disciples were in the boat and then there was a storm and Jesus comes walking saying, "Take courage, don't worry, I am here." And that's the same thing that God was telling Paul, that he will take care of him despite all that's happening. But more than that, I think it's about God's providence as well. You see, it wasn't just to encourage Paul, but it was also reminding Paul that as he testified in Jerusalem, that's not the end of Paul. He, through God, will be brought to Rome. And I think that's God's providence. God was telling Paul that he has plans for him and his life won't end in Jerusalem, but be protected. And he will then be in Rome testifying to God or testifying to people about God. And this is how someone defined providence. The word providence is made of two words, pro, meaning before, and this writer put video, V-I-D-O, meaning to see. The word providence simply means to see before. So when we talk about the providence of God, we mean that God sees before and plans accordingly. Tom, do you understand that? That God is a providence and God will protect Paul by seeing ahead and making sure that Paul is protected. I hope you will see that too as you listen to me. You see, the providence of God is seen in such an interesting way where 40 men willingly to speak about their vow and talk and their task of killing Paul, and the curious nephew who would eavesdrop. This is the picture how it looks like. And I still think it's very strange that a little boy could eavesdrop this big plan that includes the includes the chief priests and some of the Pharisees. It is, to me, a providence of God. But more than that, the nephew, a small boy, will approach a Roman centurion to tell this story. And then the centurion will trust this boy and bring him to a commander. To me, that again is God's providence. Why would a centurion want to listen to a Jewish boy? Especially about Paul. Paul is not his friend. Paul is someone under guard. And Paul is someone that they want to really get rid of because he's a troublemaker. So let me just put it this way. The providence of God can be seen that though 40 men were making a vow, a little nephew, a boy, would eavesdrop and hear this plan and then to report to Paul. More than that, we get a receptive centurion willing to listen to Paul, who's under guard, and this boy, this nephew. Moreover, this centurion would then present this boy to the commander, who would then take drastic action of ordering 400 soldiers and 70 horsemen just to protect Paul. When I think of it, it's like one of those movies where there's a plot, a counterplot, and a resolution. I think if you cannot see the hand of God in the various places that this plan could have been spoiled, that how a young nephew could hear, a commander would believe, and a commander would act. Anyway, I would like to suggest that it's indeed the providence of God. But that's not all. Providence of God also happened among us, where God provides for things. I want to give you a few examples of how this is happening among us, with the idea of the computer, the bandits, job and health, and my wife and kids. Did you know that we have a group of people going to Tong San, and I just heard that someone wants to donate computers for them. They too have COVID-19 and they can't go to school. And someone now wants to offer them computers so that they can have home-based learning. God provides again. Did you know too that we have nurses in Serene Home? And we have this project called The Bandits. And there are people wanting to contribute to the nurses to keep their spirits up by providing them food, as you can see there, and fellowship. And even provide them iPads and a speaker so that they can join us for our service as well. Did you also know that there are people among us that God are providing for? Here's Chiwi, Pastor Lena's brother. If you did not know, he had a stroke. And now he's able to walk. It is again the providence of God to provide and bring health. And I think before he was bedridden or in bed for a long while. And we're thankful for God that provide providence of this. There's also another story of another brother in church who told us that during this COVID-19, he lost his job. He was downcast, very sad, and almost depressed. Again, by some providence of God, he managed to get a job from an unusual source, showing how God does provide for us. Let me end by this one, God's providence for me. As you can see, I got four lovely children that I'm trying to enjoy. And you, of course, know, if you didn't, you can't have four children without a wife. And that's my lovely wife. Did you know my first encounter with my wife wasn't very positive for me? I met her and in-laws at a church camp, and in my aggressive, extroverted self, introduced myself to her, not knowing that she was repelled by my aggressive, forward, extroverted self. She, being an introvert, was thinking, wow, this one's so aggressive one. Don't like. But by God's providence, God sent me to Sydney and reconnected again. And with my charming self, with God giving the opportunities, I want her again. Thank God for that. And now she's my wife and we have four kids. So, during this COVID-19, what has God provided for you? Do we have time to pause before we get into the hustle and bustle of life, when life goes back to the usual, to think about what has God provided? For some of us, He's provided a job. For others, He's provided us family and friends. For others, He'll provide opportunities. You see, one of the ideas of God's providence is always thanksgiving. And I think it's great, before we really finish Circuit Breaker, to take a stop, to pause, to think, to count God's blessing of His providence in our lives, so that we can take time to remember who this God is and to thank Him for it. So Tom, and the rest of us, to know, to actually take time to pause, to remember of God's providence. So that's my first point. God's providence, as seen in Paul, and hopefully in our church and in us. My second point is about Paul on trial while God is at work. You see, in this trial, there are three characters, three charges that are put to Paul, and Paul three defenses, but at the end, God is at work. Let me explain it. Here's a picture of Paul, or painting of Paul in chain, explaining to Felix and his wife, and then the high priest is seated there. It's just a very tense courtroom scene. You don't feel the tension until, let me try to draw it out for you. The three characters, the high priest, Ananias. We already know Ananias does not like Paul. At the Sanhedrin, he was trying to get rid of Paul and put him to death. So here is a character that is not a friend of Paul. More than that, they hired a lawyer. If you know any of the American scene, if they're going to present their case before a governor and the high priest is coming, they'll hire the best lawyer ever. So I believe lawyer Tertullus is a good and a high-powered lawyer. And if you see his introduction to the case, you can see that he was a well-spoken one and a very clever lawyer to praise and to almost pat Felix before he presented his trial. Some people said that was a great speech to introduce the trial and to praise Felix and to curry favor him. So that's what this one was about. But more than that, Governor Felix has been known to be a ruthless, licentious, and cruel governor. It's been said that he put off a lot of troublemakers very ruthlessly with the Roman soldier. So think about it. Paul is put in prison, waiting 5 days before he appear before Felix. He may know that the high priest is coming, but he may not know, or he would not know, what the charges are. So really, Paul is standing there and spending time with God trying to figure out how to answer the charges. And I think he did such a great job. That term is as a speech that saved his life. You see, the three charges were this. The first charge was sedition. And the implication is this. Sedition means people were going against Roman law, like rioting, which he was accused of, and was punishable by whipping, and jail, or jail, and death. Barabbas, the one that was released at Jesus' trial, was someone who was caught for sedition. So it was a serious charge. The second charge was sectarianism. What that means is this. See, when Roman soldiers or when Rome conquered Israel, they only allowed one religion, Judaism. Therefore, they allowed the Jews to operate in their religion with no other religion allowed. So when they accuse Paul of having another religion or sect, they're saying that this is against the Roman law. If that's the case, it's punishable by jail, whipping, or you get rid of this guy. So that was the other consequence of what they accused him of. Of course, the last one is sacrilege, because they accuse him of giving trouble to the Jews in the temple. They may not have a law to deal with that, but what they could do is to hand this person over to the Jewish council, Sanhedrin, and let them do what they want with someone desecrating their temple. And of course, with desecration, they would put him to death. So the charges are serious. Before this stands court, Paul was fighting for his life. I do not think that, like in our American courts or Singapore court, Paul could read his charges. He went in blank. He went in ready to defend himself, but not knowing what was going to be said, not knowing who's going to be there. So you must hear the tension there. And you must also see how Paul answered in such a miraculous and such a providential way that I think a speech that saved his life. So Tom, and the rest of you, Don't worry. It's good to know that this speech was really a great speech because Paul knew God. I believe he must have spent 5 days spending time with God, praying to God, and asking for wisdom. And this is exactly what he said, if you allow me to summarize. Paul 3 defenses with this. He said against the first one that he was causing trouble, or causing riot, sedition, was this. I've been out 12 days in Jerusalem, and there were no riots or no disturbance in Jerusalem itself. So how could you say I was causing trouble? That answers the first charge of sedition. In the second charge of sectarianism, in his very smart, wise way, he just said, my belief came from the same as Judaism. And there's nothing different because he believed in the law and the prophets. And more than that, he says that he offers a new life. Such a great way to answer the charge of sectarianism when he says it came up from Judaism, which the Romans allowed. And in terms of sacrilege or desecrating the temple, he said he was bringing offering and gifts to the poor, and he went to the temple. How could he desecrate the temple if he was already ceremonially clean? So in all the charges, he defended Lee very well that they had no response. But what I would like to add is God was working through Paul in this ways. One, Paul was very calm, collected, and clear. Two, Paul's heart is to strive for a clear conscience before God and man. I also like the idea that he said he was offering, bringing offerings and gifts for the poor in the temple. I would like to suggest this was a good way to tempt Felix. You see, Felix accepted bribe, as you read later on, and many people said that Felix was kind of a corrupt governor. To say that Paul was bringing offerings and gifts to the poor, he may have tempted Felix to say, this man has money. This man can give me bribe. And maybe I can get some bribe for him and I should maintain his life. So I thought that was very wise. And I'm not sure whether Paul used it, but I just like to suggest this. But the last one, resurrection was preached in an interesting and enticing way. Did you see what it said in chapter 24, verse 16? Let me read that to you. It says this. Oh, sorry. It's actually in chapter 14. Oh, 15, sorry. And I have the same hope as God, as this man, that there will be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. What an interesting way to talk about life after death. Some commentators said that's a good way to draw Felix in, that there is a life after death for both the wicked and the righteous. And I think that's why Felix and his wife, who's a Jew, wanted to hear him more. As we read later on, they did call him and they did talk to him about Jesus, about self-control, about wickedness and righteousness. I really think, Tom, and to you guys, Paul was really, really smart and wise. He could preach his gospel in a way to entice and still tell the truth. That was such a great way to draw Felix in. And in the end, Felix was indecided and decided to keep Paul alive. If nothing else, I think God worked through Paul to ensure that he will fulfill Acts 23:11 to testify in Jerusalem and in Rome. So I would like to say that Paul really spent time with God in the 5 days, but more importantly, he knew God. He knew God's word so much so when his life was at stake. He could manage it. He could use it in such a way that it entice people into the gospel. I too think that we can learn from Paul. And I think during this circuit breaker, I pray that we spend much time learning God's word, learning how can apply to our lives and how we can use it to tell people the gospel. For me, It just shows that Paul really knew God and His Word. So, let me conclude by saying two things. This chapter is about God's providence, of God providing a way out for Paul in such an unusual way that you cannot but say God's hand worked to protect Paul, to protect his life from the ambush of 40 angry Jews. And of course, in the trial, I would like to say Paul knew God so much and His Word that was able to present it even in the crisis time, even in the fight for his life, in such a unique, enticing way that this speech saved his life. So much so that Felix would not want to decide on his fate and even wanted to talk to him more so that he could get bribed, but ask him questions about this resurrection of the wicked and the righteous. So, what can we learn before Circuit Breaker is over? I pray that you, Tom, and the rest of us will spend time thinking about God, spending time about learning about God, and also put time before we get into the full-blown of Singapore life of the hustle and bustle. I too like to now end with two quotes from a very good servant and faithful servant of God, of Ravi Zachariah. If you did not know, this past week, he has gone and he's passed away due to cancer. He's now with the Lord. And his honour at two quotes, which I think will apply to us. The first is this. He says, "You have to plan your devotion to God every day. And the best time to plan is it is before your days begin. If you don't plan it, your day will plan you. And so, I make a disciplined life of the study of the Scripture, reading the Word every day." What encouragement from a faithful servant. I also like this, and I think this applies to a lot of Singaporeans, including me, which says, "Many Christians have so busied themselves with programs and activities that they no longer know how to be silent and meditate on God's Word and recognizing the mysteries that are in the person of Christ." What a great reminder that before Circuit Breaker is over, before Safe Nation, Safe Transitioning opens up to all of us, for us to pause, to remember, to spend time with God so that He can use us when Circuit Breaker is over and we can be used by Him to spread His gospel. Thank you, and let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you have given Paul life, protected his life both when he was in the barracks and when he was on trial. Thank you that you continue to be the God that provides, the God that's faithful, and a God that's full of grace. Help us, O Lord, that before Circuit Breaker is over, to plan time to spend time with you, to put time in our lives before it gets too busy, to acknowledge who you are and all the blessings you've given us, and to remember about how we can build our relationship with you. Thank you for this morning, and ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
respond and reflect to what we just heard with the song Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me.
May the blessing of God, the giver of every good and perfect gift, and of Christ, who summons us to service, and of the Holy Spirit, who inspires generosity and love, be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.